Now on BBC World News, Karishma Vaswani finds out how oil-rich Kazakhstan plans to achieve an ambitious new goal to meet half of the country's energy needs with renewable sources by 2050. Talking business.
Kazakhstan, Central Asia's largest economy, blessed with natural resources like coal, oil, and uranium. But when global oil prices fell, this country's fortunes suffered too. Now it's looking to renewable energy for its next phase of growth. But how is it going to make that happen? Welcome to Talking Business. I'm Karishma Vaswani, and welcome to the Astana Expo in Kazakhstan. This expo is all about showcasing Kazakhstan's vision for itself. By 2050, the government wants half of this country's energy needs to come from renewable energy, like wind, water, and solar power. The man behind this vision, President Nazarbayev. He's led Kazakhstan for more than two decades. The capital Astana is his brainchild, this expo is his initiative, and the renewable energy's vision is his plan. Sure, Kazakhstan has lots of wind, water, and sun, but what it has more than anything else is oil and coal. So how's that going to square with these plans? A question I put to Kazakhstan's Minister of Energy.
We've created regulations to attract investors into renewable energy, and it is working. The sector is becoming more attractive for foreign investors. We've signed an agreement with one of the biggest wind and solar firms in Saudi Arabia and Chinese companies. All of them want to work with us. We are negotiating with them.
But foreign investors tell us that the legislation isn't clear. They're worried about long-term viability of their business operations because of the volatility in the currency. And they're concerned that there aren't enough incentives being provided by the government for them to invest.
We understand that foreign companies face certain risks because they will earn their profits in our local currency, which has been volatile. We are trying to take the risks away from them by tying tariffs to the currency. So if the local currency drops, then tariffs will rise.
When we speak to local people, they say that as admirable as these renewable energy targets are, how are they going to boost the economy of Kazakhstan? Because right now a lot of people feel it's just boosting the image of Kazakhstan, not the actual economy.
The cost for renewable energy production has fallen by 40 to 60%, and by the year 2020 it will be even cheaper. We think within a few years the cost of renewable energy will be close to the cost of electricity we today generate from traditional resources. It will be competitive. There will always be pessimists and there will be optimists, and we will support them.
How are you going to look after the people who are employed in old fuel economies like the coal sector and the oil and gas sector as you make this transition?
The transition will happen step by step, each year till 2050. Within this time, we can diversify our production. Professions can be changed, lives can be changed. We don't expect it to be easy. We need to change the culture. It's important for our people to understand the benefits of using renewables for the environment.
I'm in the energy best practices area. This is where foreign and domestic companies are showcasing their ideas and solutions for innovation in this sector. There's a reason they're here. The potential in Kazakhstan is huge. But what are the realities? Joining me now to talk about this are Kairat Kelimbetov, he's the governor of Astana International Financial Center, Nandita Prashad, managing director of Energy and Natural Resources at the EBRD, and Bela Ferenzi, CEO of GE Central Asia and Azerbaijan. Thank you all for joining us today. I want to start with you, Mr. Kelimbetov. Why the urgency for Kazakhstan to get to these renewable energy goals and targets? Why is Kazakhstan doing this?
We are more well-known like an oil-rich country, which we now produce 1.6 million barrels per day. We're going to double it in the next 15, 20 years. But the recent events and kind of a dramatic shifting on commodities prices, especially in oil sector, driven by the new factor, technology factors, disruptive technology like shale oil, for example, in the United States from one side, just give us ideas that probably the era of high prices for oil is over from one side. And from the other side is other disruptive technologies, for example, like new automobile tendencies, like you see driverless cars, more focus on electric energy. And I think that this is really kind of paradigm shifting. So everybody realized now that the technologies are shifting and changing and disrupting. And in these terms, Kazakhstan understand it, and we should be very, very well from one side. And from the other side, it's kind of a business model of the country is changing.
Nandita, is that your sense, working here with the EBRD, that, you know, there's a real desire to move into this direction?
Yeah, absolutely. And if I could just add to what Mr. Kelimbetov said very, very clearly, there is a big commitment here under Paris to reduce emissions. While this is an oil-producing country, 70% of the electricity system here, it runs on coal. And the power sector, which is both electricity and heat, actually contributes 80% of Kazakhstan's carbon emissions. So if In tandem with this paradigm shift, it's absolutely essential that Kazakhstan will have to transition away from coal. And, you know, really gas and renewables is the only way that they can do this in any substantial material way. And I think also the sharp decline that we have seen in the cost of renewables recently, in particular if you look at solar, you know, Kazakhstan adopted in 2013 their green economy transition concept. Just between 2013 and now, so, you know, solar prices have dropped almost 80%. So there's also a real economic imperative now to launch into this next phase.
Bela, from a corporate perspective, what kinds of opportunities are you seeing in Kazakhstan, given that there is this push and this direction that the strategy is going in?
The strategy itself is very well thought through. It's very ambitious. It sounds today very ambitious, but it's a very long-term strategy. So I think if we continue to work towards that actively, all the participants, the financial arms, the government, and the investors and producers, we can get there. So I see it as realistic.
Mr. Kelimbetov, in terms of renewables, you know, in the sort of overall development of Kazakhstan, I understand that this expo, for instance, it will be turned into a massive financial center once the expo is completed. But how much will renewables make up as part of the overall strategy for Kazakhstan in the future?
Yeah, I think, first of all, it's a change in mind in the country. So on the level of the central government, local governments, and people of Kazakhstan. So I think the idea of this expo is the future energy. And so from one side is a kind of a message to the external communities that Kazakhstan understands and very much committed and wants to adopt any kind of the new technologies here in Kazakhstan and be kind of a regional hub for the Central Asia in these terms. But from the other side, it's inward message in terms of to the people of Kazakhstan, just to say the new way of thinking about how to use the energy, how to think about the future energy. And in our strategy up to the 2050, the role of renewable energy should be like 50%, starting from current 3%, which is, I think, very ambitious goals. But I think, so this is like the way which we should start from now. And we would like to use these opportunities in terms of this expo to really kind of create legacy of Expo. So the legacy of Expo would be not just the kind of physical infrastructure, which would be part of the Astana International Financial Center, but kind of the new understanding and new perception of Kazakhstan in terms of the development of green technologies.
And Nandita, you know, from your experience of overseeing these projects in Kazakhstan, do you get the sense that these targets are achievable?
No, absolutely. I think they are achievable, but as Bela said very correctly, this is going to need a coalition of interests, both public and private. We really need the policymakers in Kazakhstan to set the framework that will make these projects viable, credible. We need the investors. And actually, to be honest, I think this expo has been fantastic in that regard. Already, just between breakfast and here, I've run into at least three different investors that I would not have expected to see in Kazakhstan. And so it's very clear that this is going to be a message both to the internal policymakers that, you know, time to get the act together, to put the framework together to make these projects happen, but also the external investor community to say Kazakhstan is open for business in this space. And for financiers like ourselves, this is just music to our ears.
All of these projects would be doable if we have a real kind of financial institution who are going to implement it. So we are talking about green bonds, we are talking about green credits, we are talking about emission trading system. So all of these ingredients would be part of the new green financial system in Kazakhstan, which will allow us to bring global, regional and local investors.
As a foreign company looking into Kazakhstan, what's your sense of what else needs to be done to get there?
We did our share in the formation of the legislation as much as we can and consulting the government. I think it's very important what was said. We call it strategy, but I think it's more of a vision. The vision doesn't need to have all the steps towards. I think what has been done in the last 3 years, though it was in some cases seemed to be the investors and for us as producers slow, it's a much longer term game which we are in. And I think what I would say, we have a very clear vision for the 3% for the 2020. That's doable, and that's where this part is now, with all these things coming together finally. I think we'll get to the finish line in the 18 and 19, and we'll do it for 20.
Great point, and I can see that there's lots more to discuss. We've been talking about all the opportunities and the potential in Kazakhstan's renewable energy space. After the break, we'll be looking at some of the challenges and the realities on the ground. Don't go away, stay with us.
The world of business doesn't stop for a second, whether you're investing for the future or seeking new opportunities around the globe, enjoying the best that life has to offer, or simply trying to put food on the table. Business, with its endless deals and innovations, underpins everything we do. So cut through the jargon and understand the forces that shape our world. Join me, Aaron Hazelhurst, for Talking Business here on BBC World News.
On Global, all the big international stories of the day, what you need to know and how it affects your world. With reporters on the scene explaining what's happening and why, plus big name guests and lively debates on the issues that matter to you. From technology, lifestyle, health and global security, to the economy and the money in your pocket. The important news of the day, all in one place, right here on Global, with me, Matthew Amrelliwala, on BBC World News.
Welcome back to Talking Business. I'm Karishma Vaswani at the Astana Expo. These pavilions are filled with energy solutions, technologies for water, wind, solar power, and atomic energy. It's exactly the direction that Kazakhstan wants to go in. But before it can even reach this stage, as I discovered when I traveled out of the city, it has a long way to go. This is what Kazakhstan says it wants power generation to look like. Massive wind turbines rotating above the Central Asian steppes, powering homes, offices, and schools. Listen to this. That's the sound of wind going at 60 kilometers per hour, and that's not even at full speed. To be honest, I'm not sure if I can keep standing. I'm honestly worried about being blown away. But this wind is one of the key reasons why Kazakhstan is so well suited for renewable energy. This wind farm is the first of its kind in the country, run by state-owned firm Samruk Energy. Right now, renewables make up less than 1% of Kazakhstan's energy production. There's room for growth, but it's unlikely to come from local companies.
The main problem for the renewable energy, that equipment is from foreign countries, because from Germany, from China, and because of financial crisis, we cannot buy a lot of them. But foreign investors can bring themselves this equipment.
And that's what the Astana Expo is for, the grand show that Kazakhstan has put on for foreign investors. But that doesn't mean they find it any easier, as I found out from California-based Primus Power, which builds energy storage solutions.
Tenge, a local currency, devaluated in 2016 more than 65%, which gives very negative effect on, especially on renewable project, because all the equipments, even small bolts, are imported. And when the investor comes, there is too much uncertainty. Government didn't set up proper rules.
This is where you live? Thank you. It's not just investors. Many Kazakhs also feel the government's strategy isn't well thought out, but few dare to speak out. So this is when they sentenced you to 3 years of no public speaking, no being able to organize protests? Lawyer and activist Bolatbek Blyalov tells me it's all for show.
They just built a few wind power plants around Astana. Why not everywhere? And why not cheaper? So people can actually use it.
But none of this is changing everyday life here. 80% of Kazakhstan still uses coal because it's cheap. And until there's a clear roadmap, Kazakhstan's lofty vision may remain out of reach. So, as you've seen, there's still perhaps a long way to go before Kazakhstan fully realizes some of these ambitious goals and the vision that it's set for itself. To discuss the challenges, we can get back to our panel with Mr. Kairat Kelimbetov of Astana IFC, Nandita Prashad of the EBRD, and Bela Ferenze of GE in Central Asia. I'd like to pick up with you again, Mr. Kelimbetov. In some of our travels across the country, we consistently heard from both foreign and domestic companies looking to invest in the renewables energy sector that it is a very noble goal, but it's still very difficult on the ground. And one of the things they pointed us to was the volatility in the currency makes it very difficult for businesses to have a sort of firm plan about how they go about doing this. They want to do it, but it's very challenging. What would you say to foreign and domestic companies looking to invest?
Kazakhstan is very well prepared to, let's say, to absorb any external shocks. We created the sovereign wealth fund, national fund, which is consists from all the oil revenues which produced by in Kazakhstan from one side, and we have over the $62 billion. From the other side, we have very flexible exchange rate policy. We have a very consistent monetary policy, and now we move to the structural reforms. And these structural reforms means change in mind in, let's say, in legislation. For example, in AFC case, we move to English common law rules, for example. From the other side is a lot of the kind of the privileges and tax exemptions for the renewable energy. And I think so all of these key ingredients will help really to do the investment to the renewable energy really commercially viable.
From your experience, is the short-term pain worth the long-term viability? Is it viable?
Absolutely. I think we have learned lessons from the short-term pain, one of which is the challenges of foreign exchange risk and certainly the devaluation of tenge, which I think was the right way in light of the structural reforms that Mr. Kelimbetov described, but it did catch some of our projects quite unawares and without with some costs. So, you know, certainly the foreign exchange risk is a very valid one, particularly when you've got foreign investors coming in, investing in a product which is really a local revenue. I think there are a few ways, though, to solve this issue, and this is not unique to Kazakhstan. We've seen this in many other countries. So one of the ways, of course, is indexation. I think the government is now more ready, particularly if they move to a very competitive auction process for the next renewable projects, where they really feel comfortable that they're getting the best possible market price, that they will be much more open to indexing this to, say, the dollar. There is also the issue of deepening the local capital markets and the local tenge market. And this is something EBRD is also very focused on. We want to do more tenge lending. We believe that projects that are generating local currency and local revenues should be financed with local currency loans. And this is another area that we're focusing on quite a bit here.
Bela, it is expensive, right? In terms of the tariffs in wind power in comparison to fossil fuel power here, it's far cheaper to consistently get your power and your electricity from fossil fuels. So you can see the hesitation for many investors.
Kazakh economy is very energy intensive, right? So all the goods produced here needs electricity, but at the same time, and it's very cheap today. So if you can't compete with a 3 cent coal-based power generated with a minimum 16 to 20 tenge wind-based production. That's a very, very difficult equation to convince the investor in that environment. But this is going to be, as we were talking about earlier, going to two directions. From one side, gradually the tariffs are going to be growing. We understand that there will be no other choice to make sure that it fits the economy and fits the challenges of the economy. At the same time, on the other side, we as producers of the equipment, we're doing everything to make it cheaper.
It should not be just like a financial comparison, just to say this is cheaper, this is more expensive. Everybody realizes that anyway, it will be kind of the global requirements to any certain industrial production which you produce, and if you produce it with a kind of very green technologies, then you would be punished anyway from one side. It's unavoidable to my mind, and it should be done like this. From the other side, let's see inside of Kazakhstan. So if we still using not very environmentally friendly technology, then it means cost to the social inclusion, to the different diseases, to the problem of the healthcare. And if you calculate everything, then we will see that it's really costly.
75% of the economy is still a fossil fuel-based economy. People are worried about losing jobs in the coal sector. They hear this vision that's coming from a sort of top-down approach, and they're wondering, what is this actually going to mean for me and my livelihood? And that's what I'm trying to get from you, to understand how do you sort of manage the expectations of the local people and ensure that the vision actually benefits everybody.
That's why we're talking that this is commitment for long term. We cannot do it overnight. But in the first phase, definitely we have to use our competitive advantage. So we have hydrocarbon energy here. We can use nuclear energy here. We can use the clean tech. So we know that even in the coal using industry, we have a lot of the new disruptive clean technology, so we're going to use it.
And if I could just add to that, I mean, you know, new energy is new opportunities. There will be opportunities for newer jobs, different kinds of jobs, but there will be opportunities for jobs. I think what's very important, and I think this government is very focused on, is vocational training, skills development, these sorts of economic inclusion actions that need to be taken. And I think Kazakhstan in that way is very progressive. You know, it's probably one of the few countries that we know among our countries of operation that has actually adopted a gender action plan, which has in it a very large component of skills development, access of jobs for women. And so I think I'm confident that Kazakhstan is exactly the kind of country with this vision that will be able to make that transition.
What else do you think companies, both foreign and domestic, from a sort of corporate perspective, need to see from the government, policymakers, to help make this vision a reality?
We need to have the guarantees, the long-term tenge financing in place to achieve that goal. I think that's obvious for everybody, and I think the most important thing is that people who understand what are they doing in the government, they very thoroughly think through. So it's just mentioned at the beginning that it's a well-thought strategy, and the fact that it goes in an evolutionary manner and not jumping through certain stages, it takes longer, but we'll get there. I think 21st century is about efficiency. It's not about selling more megawatts into Kazakhstan. If technically speaking, Kazakhstan has reserves and that they would not need extra capacities today in Kazakhstan for a short-term or mid-term future. But at the same time, there are ways how to improve the efficiency of the existing assets.
Thank you for joining us for this edition of Talking Business. That's it from me, Karishma Vaswani. We're leaving you with some shots of the Astana Expo. Enjoy.